Well, on Friday, so I couldn't come to my original slot. And I know a few people I've bumped into said they wanted to see it and couldn't because of the it being so late. So thanks for coming. And I suspect loads of people are interested in the networking stuff as well. So thanks for choosing me over the networking thing. I hope I don't disappoint you. So I want to talk about something that has kind of intrigued me for the last 10 years. Did a module of it as part of my mathematics degree. So the topic's called combinatorial game theory. And it's a theory. It's nothing to do with the game theory that everybody knows about, so the Nash equilibria or all that kind of stuff. It's a very, very different, theory. So it's about two-player games of perfect information. That means that it's not like battleships where I don't know where your ships are. It's more like it seems to be a helicopter. It's more like perhaps chess, where you can see the opponent's pieces. And there's also, in these games, no chance element. And there's something called normal form, which means if you can't move, then you lose. So the games are all structured so that, as I say, if you can't move, you therefore lose the game. So there's two basic kinds. And an impartial game, both players have the same moves. That's less common in reality. And partisan games, as in different moves for different players. So I can only touch the white pieces, you can only touch the black pieces. Chess is therefore a partisan game. No chance element rules out things like backgammon or cards or anything where you roll the dice, etc. So we're talking about games where you can see all the pieces, you know what the moves are, and the idea is if you've ever written a game playing algorithm, maybe using alpha, beta, pruning or whatever, you can say at every stage in the game, well, what state can I take this game in? What are the legal moves for me, and what are the legal moves for my opponent? So that's the basic idea. I can look at a position, and I can say, well, what are all the positions I can take this to? What are all the positions my opponent can take this to? So an example game would be Chomp. So Chomp is a game played on a grid. The red square is poisoned. You choose a square as a move, so it's perfect information, obviously. And it's an impartial game because obviously there's no player one moves or player two moves. The first player is usually called left, second player is usually called right. By convention, I won't give the end away. So I choose any square, so first player chooses that square, and the idea is all of the things to the left, all the things to the right and up of the square that you choose disappear. So first person's moved, second person moves. First person moves again, second person moves, and now we're running out of moves. Remember, the person who can't move loses, so I've forgotten the parity, sorry. First person moves, second person moves, first person moves, second person moves, first person moves, second person moves. Now the first person's lost, right? Because he or she cannot move. So let's get this right. First person moves, second, first, second, and now it's the first person's move, but there's no legal moves. You can't eat the poisoned one, so the first person loses. Is that clear? Yeah. So that's how we play these games. So there's a proof, and this is a really interesting, it's not a constructive proof, but it's a nice mathematical proof of the fact that the first player should always win. So my play then was suboptimal. So there is a winning strategy for the first player, and the idea is, if there was, let's assume, for contradiction, that there is a winning strategy for the second player, the first player makes this move in the top right corner, then whatever move the second player takes in their winning strategy, the first player could have taken it, couldn't it? Because it's still a legal move for him. So is that? It's a bit subtle. It's not a constructive proof of a winning strategy for the first player, but it's called a strategy stealing argument. If there was a strategy for the second player, the first player could steal it by making this move, and then if there's a response that the player two can give, he could have done that in the first place, and he can therefore steal the strategy. So that's one neat way of using a logical argument to show that, yeah, it should be a win for the first player, even if you can't quite construct it. And one interesting thing for you to think about after the talk is, what about the game Chompfinity, where it's on an infinite board, so you can choose any N and any M, as your first block, and then you obviously disappear all greater than that. Does that change the nature of the game, or does it? Or does it not? So Chumpfinity, an exercise for the interested among you. So, the first game I want to talk about. This is a game that was first solved, I think, in the Victorian times, and the game is called Nim. The rules are as follows: you have piles of coins, and you can on any particular pile, you can remove any number of them, and you can take up to all of them if you want. So, for instance, I can take three on the left-hand side row, or I can take just one off the most right-hand side. And the idea is, again, we're in normal form. The player that can't move loses. So a Nim pile with one, a Nim game with one pile is really boring, because what is the winning strategy for the Nim pile with one pile?
What's
the objective? Take them all. The objective is to stop the other person being able to move. Remember, we're in normal form. So yeah, you're right, take them all. A little bit more subtle is the winning Nim strategy for two piles. I'll let you think for a couple of seconds. Go on. Take all but one off one is not the correct answer, but it's a good try. And thanks for volunteering so quick. It's a non-trivial problem, but I know if possible you have a good instinct. Maybe is that a second guess? Again, equalize them. Did I imagine that, or did I hear it? Yes, okay, awesome, here's the right answer. I was going to say, if I just hallucinate in the right answers, then this is going to be really good. Only it might not actually be true. So you all understand, great, yeah. So yeah, you equalize them, and then whatever they do, you can do on the other one. So if she takes one, you take two off the right, so she's left with three and three. She takes two off the left one, you take two off the right one, and then they're always balanced then. And if they're always balanced, at some point, that goes to zero, you take the other one to zero, they've lost. So we can solve Nim for two piles now. So now a more complicated Nim position. Have these come in the wrong order? Yes, a more complicated Nim position. So there's a little bit of subtlety here. Nim can be considered as the sum of several different small games. If you treat the sum of two games to be not like chess boxing, where you have to do chess and then boxing, or boxing then chess, or whatever's the most difficult way around, it's where at any point in the game, there's two games, so there's draughts here, and there's chess there, and you choose, well, which game for this turn, which game am I going to play in? I'll play in draughts. And I make my move, and then you make your move, and you get the choice, which game do I play in? Nim is somehow, it's four different games of Nim, potentially. You can choose, am I playing in this one, or am I playing in this one? And I'll go into this in a bit more detail in a minute, but the idea is, if I was playing in the game with just these two, I've got a strategy, haven't I? And if I was playing in the game with just these two, if that was one, I'd have a strategy. So a good idea might be, well, I'll keep those two, and I'll equalize these two, and then presumably if my opponent makes a move in these two, I'll do the winning game. If my opponent makes a move in these two without these as the single ones, I'll make a move in that winning game. So somehow I've decomposed this four pile into two games that I know I can win, and if my opponent plays in one of them, I give the winning response in it. Does that make sense? Brilliant. Okay, so much harder now. Whenever you read about this, they always talk about binary arithmetic, but I find it easier to actually think about it in terms of powers of two. So the idea is you want the sum, the binary sum without carrying, to equal zero. So it's binary addition, but without, it's modulo two, you don't carry. So there's a one here, there's a two here, there's a four here, and there's a two here, and a one. So the idea is the one and the one cancels, the two and the two cancels, and the best move for me is, in fact, to remove the four. So I'll do a worked example in a minute, but does it sound plausible that removing this four is a winning move? Yeah, it does, because if you think about what's left, if I remove these, there's three, two, one. Think about what the opportunities are for the opponent. If the opponent takes this one, you equalize those two. If the opponent takes this one, those two are equal and you can remove all of them. If the opponent takes both of these, you're in this one and you can equalize. If the opponent takes one of these are equal and you can remove this one. If the opponent takes two of these are equal and you can remove that one. If the opponent takes three of these are not equal and you can equalize and then win. So that does sound plausible, that removing the four there is a win. I meant to do that without... Yeah, you know what I mean, don't you? You imagined that the fourth was gone then when I was speaking, didn't you? Even though I was speaking fast. Pardon me? I'm a little deaf. I was unwell on Friday, and I've got a cold, this ear completely closes, so it's going to be the worst bit of audience participation ever. So let's say you had 17, 25, and 13 in a pile, and they usually do it with binary 0 and 1 notation, but I think it's much clearer. So what we're looking for, we're going to say the 16s cancel, we're going to say the 1s there cancel, they have to cancel with a different row. So the 16s cancel, the 8s cancel, the 1s cancel. It'd be really good if the 4 plus 1 wasn't there. And that's exactly what the winning strategy is. So all of those things cancel. It'd be really good if the 4 and the 1 weren't there, because then everything would cancel. And the winning strategy at that point is to take the 13 down to an 8. So if you keep that, if your strategy is always make the sum, this special so-called NIM sum, which is binary addition without carrying, make that 0 all the time. If it's already 0, you're screwed if the other person knows how to play. But if they're not, you make it 0. And it's this sort of... I forgot where I was in my slides. It's this sort of argument of, I don't need to get the best move. I just need to make sure I've always got a move. So if I know that I just turn it to 0 again and that's a lose, and then if I can turn it to 0, and then we just go down, and because we're always decreasing the piles, at some point we're going to get to actually there being nothing there, and hopefully that's when you've got it. And this kind of parity type argument, keeping this NIM sum 0 is kind of what is preserved and what guarantees the win. So that might be worth thinking about away from here. I've got 60 slides and 45 minutes, so I'm going to have to move on. So one interesting thing, though, is let's say as well as normal NIM, there's a special game in NIM where you can add coins if you want. So in a particular position, I can just pile on 100 coins on a row. Can anyone think why that isn't necessarily helpful? Again? Exactly, they can just remove them. So it's actually, the move is completely reversible. If I add 50 coins onto one pile, and that's a worse position for you, you can just take exactly 50 coins off and say, like, deal with that. Or if it's better for you, you can say, oh, nice one, and sort of play on. So it can only make things worse for the person doing it, basically. So there's no point in adding that extra rule. You're just wasting time. Does that make sense? So this concept of reversibility. Some moves actually have an option that just either takes you back to where you were or actually gives you something worse. So there's another game called Kales. So the game here is you've got a bunch of piles again, similar to NIM, but this time you can remove any one or two adjacent bowling pins. So I could take these two and leave one, I could take these two and leave two piles, each of one, etc. So you can actually take... say any two adjacent, and you're allowed to split the piles in this game. So a very similar game. And the theory says, and this has been known for a while, maybe I wasn't so explicit, but these games are all impartial, right? There's no such thing as moves that only the left player can make. So in these impartial games, there's a theory called the Sprague-Grundy theorem that says they're all equivalent to NIM somehow. So there's a really nice... theorem that comes later. And some things that aren't impartial, there might be a sneaky way of making it impartial. So Northcote's game is played with on a checkers board, and you can move your pieces up and down arbitrarily. And if the other, except you can't jump against, you can't jump over the other people. You can move up and down in your row arbitrarily. You've got two of them here, say. You can move up and down arbitrarily. I keep saying that as if you haven't heard me the first four times. And then, so the idea is sometimes you retreat, sometimes you come closer. But if he comes closer, this gap goes down, doesn't it? If this person comes up, the gap goes down. If this goes backwards, nothing really happens. It's these gaps are basically your nim, aren't they? And going backwards is just like adding. It's like that silly extra rule of nim that does nothing. So this is a partisan game. I can only move my pieces, and she can only move her pieces. But actually, it's just nim in disguise. So nim in disguise is going to be the big idea for when we get to play the childhood game of dots and boxes. Is everybody... How do you win? When the other person can't move. So because if I keep moving up here, eventually white can't move because they can't jump past me. If I keep moving up here, black can't go this way. So I'm just closing the gap on black. And if they retreat, I can follow them, right? But they can't retreat forever. Yeah? No, sorry, I wasn't clear. It's up and down is the legal moves in this game. Sorry, I almost certainly wasn't clear if everyone's confused. I didn't actually look in detail at this board, to be honest. I just Googled for one.
So all the blacks are on one side and all the whites are actually on the other.
This is a legit game. I'm not sure it is. Which one's bothering you? The point is, though, that actually it's the gap between the pieces. It doesn't matter whether black's on top or bottom. It's the gap between the pieces is important. And both players have got a choice, basically. Am I closing the gap? Am I increasing the gap? And someone's going to get trapped at either edge. It isn't the blacks on the bottom and whites on the top. Does that make sense? You can just close the gap. And if I get closer to you, your only move is to escape, and I just follow you up to the edge. Does that make sense? I don't... Can we just call this dealt with? I vote for just calling this dealt with. I Googled for Knockouts game, took an image, didn't look at the context of the bounding page. Trust me, Knockouts game is equivalent to Nim because Sprague Grundy theory says that all impartial two-person games of perfect information are equivalent to Nim. So I'm glad you all understand that. So, moving swiftly on, there's a whole class of games called octal games, and they're described by a potentially infinite octal number like this, and the idea is a bit like file permissions in Unix. If the nth position says you can take n things off your pile, and if you're allowed to leave zero piles, then you add one to the total. If you're allowed to leave one, then you add two to the total. If you had to split and leave two piles, you add four to the total. So Kales, if you remember, you're allowed to take one or two pins, and you're allowed to leave zero, one, or two piles, weren't you? You could take the last of a pile, you could leave two piles, or you could leave one pile. So Kales is actually the game 0.77, because I can take one and leave zero, one, or two piles, or I can take two and leave zero, one, and two piles. Audience participation, and I wanted to shout loud if you know the answer because I can't actually hear. What's the decimal number, what's the octal game number, sorry, for Nim?
One.
One? What makes you say one?
It's a bad guess.
It's a bloody good guess, but it's not quite true. It's very, very, it's very, very nearly true. So can you leave two piles in Nim? No, we had no splitting, did we? Can you leave zero piles in Nim? I think you can, can't you? You can take some and leave none, yeah? Can you leave one? You can take some and leave some, can't you? So it's definitely three, but can you take what? How many pieces can you take? In Kales, you could only take one or two. In Nim, there's no limit, is there? So Nim is 0.33333 recurring. Yeah? So you can take any number, and you can leave either zero or one pile. Yeah? You can't split in Nim. And Spray Grundy says, every impartial two-person game is equivalent to NIM, and the way you solve them is you find the NIM equivalents, you play in NIM, it's like you're playing two games at once, a move in this game is a move in NIM, you find the winning move in NIM and translate it back into the game, and it's bloody brilliant. And there's the NIM equivalent values for Kales. It's an unsolved question just yet, and this is if anyone is wanting to get involved in some mathematics. After this is 72 plus 12. After that, it cycles, and all of the octal games have actually, anyone that's been explored has actually eventually become periodic in terms of its NIM equivalent numbers. So do you see what I mean? A pile of n Kales is equivalent to these NIM piles, and you can add them the way I described, which is choose which one you play in, and then you can take a move in any of the choices. So after 72 plus 12, after 84, I guess, the same cycle repeats the same. And everyone they've tried cycles, but they haven't proved that it always cycles. It's quite interesting. So another game called Col, so-called because it's cold, which means something I'll explain in a minute. Red and blue are the players. Blue is left, but I might have forgotten that when I made the slides. So a move is to colour in a region, and Col, the rules are, if I colour a region, I cannot colour an adjacent region. So if red plays the outside, then he's kind of reserved this for blue, because red can't go there. Does that make sense? So when blue then goes, blue's kind of reserved this for herself, but she can't go there. So now this is kind of reserved for red. But what is a good move for red, in fact, in this case? Take the white one, exactly, because then blue's got nowhere to go. Oh, no, I'm lying, aren't I? Actually, blue can go in the one that's reserved for blue. Wow. So blue's response is this, takes it. Ah, no, you're right. I forgot to colour it in. Ah. Yes, I didn't. I'm just colourblind as well. I'm looking at this. So see how it goes? Grey? Grey is not usable by either. It's a difference between turquoise and grey, excuse me. It's traditional to do cross hatches of the ones that you can't go on, but I just didn't have the gimp foo to do it, so it's confusing me, excuse me. So yeah. It's reserved for blue. Now no one can go in that space. And yeah, the man there is exactly right. That's a winning move for red. So you will be able to beat me at all of these games because I'm actually shit. So Snort now is a hot game. Snort is different to Col in that any time you move into a segment, the adjacent segments are reserved for you rather than for your opponents. So the thing with Snort is you want to play in that game because the more moves you make in that game, the better. Whereas in Col, the more moves you make, you're just reserving space for your opponent. So hopefully this is the right way around and I'm not colorblind. So blue now has reserved those for himself. Red's actually only got one choice. Now everything goes gray because blue's reserved a bunch of them. Red's reserved a bunch of them. But now blue can't go, so blue loses. Is that clear? Oh, yes. I forgot. You are paying attention. I forgot there was an outside. I originally wanted to make it the lozenge, but then I couldn't paste it into Google presentations. But you guys are bloody good. It's not the lozenge we're playing in, of course, the outside, yeah. You passed the test. So quite often with these games, there's like a parity type argument. And you always say, you know, I don't need to find the best move. I just need to ensure I always have a move. You know, like every time you move, if I've got a move, then I win because you run out eventually. So it's called the parity always comes into it. And it's like the simplest possible game is like, she loves me, she loves me not, she loves me, she loves me not. You're really asking what's the parity of the petals, aren't you? You're not actually sort of doing anything other than that. So yeah, just wanted to remind myself about the parity type argument. So now, kids game in school, you may well remember dots and boxes. So you've got a grid and you draw lines. Every move someone does a line. Eventually something like this happens. This is what professionals call a blunder, because you would never actually let someone complete a square at this stage. So as you all know, eventually, and without blunder, so level zero play, like if you're a kid and you think about it for more than like a minute or so, you realize that you don't want to complete three sides on a square. You want to avoid that as long as possible. And something like this happens to the board. And then, unfortunately, someone's unlucky enough, they have to open a chain, right? Whoa, whoa, whoa. So we're calling these chains. Somebody at some point has to open a chain. And from then, either they're not...
Shit.
This is... I planned this. A bit of a...
Hello.
Okay.
Just rewind it.
All that. We'll take it out in post-production. It's fine. So, important mathematics. You avoid blunders, basically. And at some point, you open up, someone's forced to open up one of the chains. And now level one play, we said level zero play is blunder avoidance. Level one play is, if I've got to open one of the chains, I'll open the smallest one first. And then someone takes the chain, they open another chain. And then, so you kind of alternate between who takes the chains. But one nice little trick, which if you know, as soon as you start doing this to people, they get the trick straight away, is if someone opens that chain, I don't take them all. I take them all except the final two and say, there you go, you have those two. And they take those last two and then they're forced to open another chain for me. I gobble up all of that chain and leave them the last two. So that's like level two play kind of thing. So also there's two kinds of things. There's chains and there's cycles. So in here is actually a cycle, whereas this starts at the end and finishes at the other end. This is a cycle. In order to be sneaky with this one, if someone opens it up, I can't leave two, but I can leave four. So I say, I don't want those four, thanks. And then they go, they get four, but then they're forced to open this. And this gives me, in fact, one, two, three, four. And in this, I would gobble up five, six, right? If there was other things going on in other parts of the board, I would say one, two, three, four. You have those two and open up somewhere else for me. Does that make sense? Yeah. So this is called the double cross. So anytime you take two squares simultaneously in dots and boxes, in particular, especially if you play it against me, you're losing, okay? So this is, you've been double crossed. So let's make sure I can remember these. If you see any of these, it means you're losing. Because you've got basically no choice, you should take them. In fact, if somebody gives you these, you should take them. It's a no-brainer because you've got no choice. You may as well take them and get the extra squares, but it probably means you're losing. Now, this is a bit of a blunder. If this is part of a game and the other board is not yet finished, if you give me this, I've definitely won. I may not know how, but I've definitely won. Because if the rest of the game is a lose for the person to move, I go there and make you play in it. Does that make sense? I close this two, leaving you these two squares. You take them, but then you have to play in the rest of the game, which is presumably a loss. If the rest of the game is a win, I just take them and then play in the winning game. Does that make sense? Yeah. So if you give me the bottom, then I've got control. I may not know what optimal play is. I may not, but which is actually quite an unsatisfying thing. It's knowing that you've won, but just not knowing how. Or knowing that you can win, rather, but not knowing how is actually more annoying than losing sometimes. So we spoke about NIM because I said gaining control is important, keeping control is important. But I always give away two at the end of every chain and four at the end of every cycle. So in the actual game of dots and boxes, it's a partisan game because the squares that are mine isn't there and the squares that are yours and all our moves aren't necessarily the same. And it also, I get an extra move whenever I complete a square. Sorry, for those who haven't played Dots and Boxes recently, whenever you complete a square, you're forced to take an extra move, which is why this control thing happens. So I should have mentioned that probably, excuse me. But what if it was impartial? So if NIMstring's impartial, the only difference between the version, if you're trying to play for whoever can't move loses, then do you remember here when I said, if this was the only game, I just gobble up all this and get the 6 points. In the normal form version, in Nimstring, I take them all, leave you these four, you take that move, but then you have to go somewhere else and you can't move, so you lose. So Nimstring, the only difference in play between dots and boxes and Nimstring is the final chain that I take, I don't gobble them all up and get the extra 2 points. I leave that bit for you and make you not have a move at the end. Does that make sense? It's a little bit subtle. So the points, if you ignore the points in dots and boxes and play the equivalent game, which is I just want to control who is the first person who moves into a chain, and then from then I win. And you win in the normal game of dots and boxes because you get most of the squares, but you win in the normal form, sorry, you win in the impartial version by making them unable to move, which by Sprague-Grundy theory means is equivalent to Nim. So there is, when you're really, really good, and I am not really, really good, you're not playing dots and boxes. You're playing, because the dots and boxes are kind of like a graph, and you know the graphs have a dual when you swap nodes for edges and edges for nodes. What really good dots and boxes playing are, they're thinking about the strings and coins game, which is the dual of the dots and boxes, and they're no longer playing the game strings and coins even. They're playing a game called Dawson's Vines, which is a similar, you know, we played Dawson's Kales before. It's a similar game to that. So that's when you're stratospherically good at dots and boxes. I'm not. I just like beating kids. And I like winning against children. I'm sorry. I'm overrunning. I'm taking too long. If you want to leave at the, is it already gone? If you want to leave at the eight, was it? I won't be too offended, but I'll try and be quick. So another game is Domineering. It's played with dominoes on a chessboard, and the idea is one person left plays vertically, one person right plays horizontally, first and second player, and eventually you fill the board up. But there's certain strategies where, if you look here, you see left has reserved herself this one, right can't move there, can she? So you've got, and also this part of the board is kind of separate to this part of the board. It's like two separate games. And would that be different to saying, well, which of these games do you want to play in? If you play in this one, make a move in it. Or you can play in this one, make a move in it. So we've got like two disjoint parts of the game, which is kind of what our theory is about. So the next person makes a move, who is right, the second player, left, the first player. And now right moves, and now left moves and wins, in fact. So though there's two squares left, they're both zero. You can't move in them. So the idea is going to be the zero game is the game where either the person to move loses, or there is no moves, because then you've lost. Yeah, does that make sense? So these games here have number values. If left is the person who plays vertically, then that's one move for left, clearly, isn't it? If that's part of your game, and if that's part of the game anywhere, you especially if it's isolated, I mean, if it's isolated, and that is a segment of the game, that's a move in the bank kind of thing, isn't it? And similarly, this is a move in the bank for right. And this, though, is much more contested, isn't it? Either left or right can play there. They both want it. That's like a hot game, so we want it. This is super hot, isn't it? If left plays here, then she's got a free move as well. If right plays here, then she's got a free move as well. So actually, that's even hotter. So of these four games, you would ignore these. You wouldn't even go for that one. You would get this one, wouldn't you, and get the extra move. Do you see how that's somehow like more desirable? That's the hottest. I'm going to go rather quickly through something slightly more technical. So John Conway, the guy who also discovered the game of life, and I think was also involved in categorizing one of the finite simple groups, so an incredibly prolific guy. Surreal numbers are defined as X is a set of numbers on the left and a set of numbers on the right, and the condition is that everything in this set is less than everything in this set. So that's a slight abuse of notation if you're going to be a little picky about the notation. But the idea is, well, we haven't said anything yet. So what is this is like a list of things that on the left, and this is a list of things on the right. And the guarantee is that each of them here is less than each of them here, pairwise. How do we bootstrap it? And as always, we bootstrap it with the empty set. So actually inserted here is no element because it's the empty set. That's defined to be zero. And then you say, well, okay, so what if I have on the right zero and then on the left nothing, and then on the left zero and on the right nothing, and then zero here. This is for now not a number, but I'll let you into a secret. It is a game. So day two, you have there's several different ways of organizing all the numbers you've seen before, and there's an addition defined on these kinds of objects, and there's a multiplication, and there's a exponentiation. So these objects are behaving like numbers. I won't go into it, but you have on day two, you actually have 2 and minus 2 and a half fill in. And in fact, I think probably 3/2 is filled in as well. I'll check in a sec. So you get the dyadic rationals. So you start getting on day n of these numbers that are being generated, you get all the numbers of the form 1 over or something over 2 to the n. So you're slowly building up. I'm bounded by above. It's much clearer if I show you the diagram. So here you've got day one, day two, and the idea is you start filling out all of these and you only have the so-called dyadic rationals. So they're only the lower part is always a power of 2. So the rule for deciding what the numbers are is it's the simplest number. So it's the number that was born on the smallest day. So between 0 and 1, the simplest thing is a half. The number that is the value of this strange notation is the number that's the simplest. So it's bigger than this number, and it's smaller than this number, and it's the simplest one in between. So that's the rule for determining surreal numbers. This is a non-unique description. I could write -1, 0 or -2, 0 here as well, but remember it's always greater than all the ones in the left and less than all the ones in the right, and it's the simplest. So games are similar. The games are the same as numbers. There's some number of left moves. So when you choose a move of all the possible positions, there's some number of moves for right. Games are similar. The only thing is games don't have this restriction on all the numbers in the left being less than all the numbers in the right. And games have this special property where, unlike numbers, games can be fuzzy or confused. So a game of zero is the person to move loses. So that's the zero game. That's in the game we don't want to play in. If anything's confused with zero, then it's not positive or negative. It's like a hot game somehow, so you do want to play in it. If a game's positive, it's actually a win for the first player. And if a game's negative, it's actually a win for the second player. So I don't have tons of time to go into how it works, but I hope I've whet your appetite. I've got some book recommendations. We said here this is for left, so this is just one extra move for left. This is right, so this would be -1. These are actually equivalent to numbers, because I said some games were numbers, right? The interesting thing here, this is 0, 0, because left can take this and leave the zero game for right. Right can take this and leave the zero game for left. This is our first. It's an infinitesimal number. It's smaller. It's confused with zero, and it's smaller than all of the positive numbers. It's confused with zero from below as well. It's greater than all the negative numbers. So this is somehow like right close to zero, but not quite. And it's neither positive nor negative. So these are the strange numbers that come in. This one, do you remember I said this was super, super hot in the game you want to get into? This, if I say, well, if I'm left, I can actually choose. I can actually go here and leave one for myself, whereas right can go here and leave one for herself. So it's 1 and -1. This game is confused with all the numbers between 1 and -1. So it's that whiff, how confused it is somehow the how hot it is and how much you want to play in it. And even I was struggling to finish these slides. That should say equals up arrow. So we said star was, and star coincidentally is Nim again. So our one star for Nim, because when you do Nim addition, you say a Nim heap of size 8 is like 8 star, and size 6 is 6 star. So you say 5 star plus 6 star, etc. So I probably didn't mention that. I forgot. Excuse me. But this is the same as one as a Nim heap of size 1, which if you think about it is right, isn't it? Because a Nim heap of size 1, I can take it or they can take it, and that's all they can do. So is that, do you see how this piece of the game would be if you were playing it alongside Nim? And that's the whole point with the game addition. You can play Nim plus this plus chess, and you just choose, well, which, for this move, which game am I playing in? Make a move in it. If this is a hot game, then the person probably wants to reply in that game. And what you do is you play the hottest game first, is the best strategy, and then you play the less hot game and all the cold games that no one wants to play in. Or if that game's, if you imagine the two games, one game is the person to move wins, and one person is the person to move loses, which is a zero game. Adding that game doesn't make a difference, because whoever wins in this game makes the other person play in the losing game. Does that make sense? That's why it's called the zero game. You add it to another game and there's no point. If you've got a game of Nim with a pile of two and a pile of two, and another game is chess, no one wants to play in that because it's a losing game, right? So we play in chess till we're done. Whoever wins chess forces chess isn't a normal form, excuse me. Play in something else that's normal form, excuse me, sorry. I was using chess as an example. You just imagine I didn't say chess. Imagine I said something else. Anyway, I've waffled enough. I hope I'm worried if you're as excited as I am, because I mean, because I can't. I don't think I've sold how awesome this idea is, as well as hours worth of reading amazing books would do, or doing a longer course or something. So. Here's some references. The Dots and Boxes game, if you want to get to the point where you're transcendently playing Dawson's Vines instead of the actual game. There's been a recent book published. The chappie coincidentally now works at Twitter on Combinatorial Game Theory. This is the sort of graduate studies one. On Numbers and Games, John Horton Conway's initial sort of 1970s description of the surreal numbers. There's an amazing 4-volume work called Winning Ways for Your Mathematical Plays, which is incredibly fun. There's one called, I've forgotten, Lessons in Play, which is also excellent, like a simpler introduction. And there's one by Donald Knuth of the Art of Computer Programming fame, who actually, he was the chap who named them the surreals. Conway always wanted to just call them numbers, and they are the maximal ordered field, so it's defensible to just call them numbers. I don't have a conclusion. I hope you enjoyed it. I really enjoyed giving it. Thanks for the answers. Sorry I couldn't hear 80% of them. Have we got time for questions, or do we have to pack up and go find out? Cool. Thank you. I'm not joking. You will have to shout if you ask a question.
Oh, we've got a question.
Absolutely. I should have had a slide on it. It's been used in chess end games and in Go end games. So there's a game by a book by David Wolfe, chap who wrote one of the books I mentioned, which is Lessons in Play. He's a co-author of that. He's got a book called, you know what I was saying about things being hot? There's a concept called chilling, and there's a book called Mathematical Go, Chilling Gets the Last Point or something. And the idea is, in a very close game, it becomes amenable to this style of analysis. So chess end games and Go end games in particular. And of course, the surreal numbers are an interesting mathematical field in themselves. They do have an analysis within them and stuff like that. So, and it's similar to a concept called Dedekind cuts. So it's not without precedent to do that kind of thing for numbers. I moved very quickly through that stuff, but it was more to sort of whet your appetite a bit. I hope that answers your question.
Any more questions? Can you explain surreal numbers again?
No. Wikipedia is actually very good for it. So, and the Knuth book is more like a... Socratic dialogue between two people that my style in this was to go from games to numbers and just dip into numbers, because the treatment going from numbers to games has been done in On Numbers and Games by Conway, and the Surreal Numbers book by Knuth just deals with the numbery aspects, and it's like a Plato style dialogue, Socratic dialogue type thing. I don't recall it being a love story, but it is. It is. I remember one of them being female, but I don't remember. I'm probably 12 years off having read the book. The only thing I remember is the tablets arrive and you go on this nice journey. I don't remember any actual sex.
Oh, any last question? Anyone? No? Okay, another big hand for Tom
Thanks Hall. For your indulgence.